This is the Think Christian podcast, where there's no such thing as secular. I'm Josh Larson. Glad to have you listening. What have you been up to during quarantine? If, like me, you've felt sort of paralyzed much of the time, then you've probably been impressed by the musical artists who have managed to conceive, record, and release surprise songs while under some form of self-isolation. Taylor Swift, always the overachiever, she even put out a whole album called Folklore. Kathryn Freeman will be on the show to talk about Folklore, and then Abby Olchesi and I will discuss Billie Eilish's new single and the video for it. That's called My Future. Now, forced to sit with themselves these past months, have these artists found a way to make music for the moment? Might their songs offer solace for us, both as music fans and Christians? Let's look for some answers, starting with Taylor Swift. So Kathryn Freeman is here, and Kathryn, I knew you kept track of Taylor Swift, but I didn't know if you were enough of a fan to want to come on the podcast and talk about her. So I emailed you, asked you, and you confessed you are indeed a full-on Swiftie. True story?
Huge Swiftie. I mean, next to Beyonce, she's the artist I've seen in concert the most amount of times. I have seen her in concert. Well, I didn't see Speak Now, but I've seen Fearless. I saw 1989. I saw Reputation. You know, if she had toured for Lover, I would have seen that too.
Yeah, that was on your radar. You were going to go again, huh?
She is a phenomenal songwriter, and she's not at Beyonce's level, but she doesn't sing the songs the way she sings them on the album, which is always, like, as a concert goer, I want something new and different. And she always gives us that.
So yeah, that tour, the Lover tour, did get canceled, as so many things with the pandemic. And instead, I guess we got this surprise album, Folklore. And she conceived and recorded it in the last couple of months. You know, like so many of us, while she was undergoing some form of self-quarantine, it seems to me Folklore has been characterized as a significant shift for Taylor Swift, both in terms of the music, the sound, and the subject matter. I don't know, Kathryn, you're more the expert than me. We have your credentials down there. So would you say that's accurate, that this represents, I don't know, has Taylor Swift been reborn in a way during quarantine, or is that a little dramatic and drastic?
I'll say a couple things. I think if any artist is likely to write an album, record it, release it in quarantine, I would say Taylor Swift would be the top of my list. I think her personality, if you watched her Netflix documentary, Miss Americana, she is, if you're an Enneagram person, she is the quintessential Enneagram 3 achiever type personality. So I'm not at all surprised that she recorded this album. I would say for me, I don't like significant shift. I'll tell you why. Taylor Swift is 30 years old. So she should not sound like she sounded when she wrote Fearless or Speak Now, just because, you know, she's lived so much life. She's in a totally different space. And so I think if she was still making that kind of music, to me, that would be a little bit alarming. But I also think maybe part of the reason for me that it's characterized as a significant shift is I do think that there's a tendency with Taylor Swift to diminish her artistic abilities and accomplishments. And so in my mind, I've always seen her on this kind of trajectory, right? Like, she does pop music. She did country. She did pop music. But I mean, if you really drill down to it, I mean, she is a songwriter. Like, the cleverness of how she phrases and strings things together. So I always kind of saw her on this, like, Dixie Chicks sort of Stevie Nicks, Sheryl Crow trajectory as she aged. I do think the sound is interesting because she recorded, the producer for this is, I can't think of his name, but he's in The National. So I do think the sound is different.
Yeah, Aaron Dessner.
Aaron Dessner. I will say, I do think one of the big differences with this album, which I would say I agree with the statement of shift, is she writes less about herself and less about her own sort of love life and ups and downs of that on this album. But I don't know that I would say, it just feels like she's growing up. Like, it just feels like an adult. And so to say it's a significant shift just feels like, well, would you expect a 30-year-old to sound like a 17-year-old? But people have that expectation because I think that they diminish her, you know, gift or her abilities. But I also think people still identify her with this kind of teeny bopper thing.
And maybe have put a ceiling on where they expect she might be able to go.
For sure.
Yeah. So that stood out, the writing, even taking on the point of view of different characters in a song or two, I think, on Folklore, definitely on One. And that struck me as a little bit different and taking us outside of that personal romantic diary element that her songs have had. But the music too, you know, you mentioned Aaron Dessner. Another new collaborator for her on this album is Bon Iver's Justin Vernon, sings with him. And so there's, to me, the pop hooks you're talking about are definitely still there. You recognize them, but they're layered in a rich sonic atmosphere, I would say, that sounds a little bit new. Basically, for me, this album had a quieter and less insistent musicality. So it was kind of like the music isn't trying so hard. And I think in a lot of her songs, even some of the good ones, you can always sense that effort. It speaks to what you were saying about her. You know, the effort is there, and that felt a little less insistent here, to me at least. So maybe we should talk about a song or two, Kathryn. Did you have one, a favorite, or one that stood out to you you wanted to highlight?
Oh my gosh, it's hard to pick a favorite, but I would say my probably top two are Invisible String and Mad Woman. I think Invisible String, because you see the sort of blank space-esque quality of her songwriting and just the cleverness and the concept of this idea of like fate and like the role of time in healing wounds, and sort of like she's not giving that sort of scorn me woman kind of, she's not in that place anymore. And I think realizing that, like, for all of us, whether it's in a relationship or some other sort of heartbreak you've experienced, how time is a healer. And also too, how even that thing that hurt you or you felt like might break you led you to the thing that was going to be your thing or was always your thing. And so I love that. And I just love the clever way that she kind of pulls that together. And that song, I think, is from her own personal story about her current partner. And then I love Mad Woman because, again, I think it is like all the things that she has gone through with like Scooter Braun and her old record label and this idea that like, which I think is, you know, the last couple of years has been an increasing part of like her public persona of like just wanting to kind of exert this control and how the narrative is switched of like, you know, it's very quickly for women, you go from like girl boss to like the B word, like you're too aggressive. And I love the song being about how really no one likes, women aren't allowed to be mad. No one likes, even if it's justified, or even for Christians, think about righteous anger. Like, we don't like our women to express that kind of feeling. But then she doesn't only put it on men. Like, even she expresses in that song that women are uncomfortable with mad women. And so, I don't know. I like this song because I feel like Invisible String is very true to kind of her historic songwriting. Okay. And I feel like Mad Woman is like who she is growing and who you get to see a lot of more of in Miss Americana in the Netflix documentary.
Let's hear a little bit of Mad Woman.
What do you sing on your drive home? Do you see my face in the neighbor's lawn? Does she smile? Does she mouth, I hate you forever? Every time you call me crazy, you're getting more crazy. What about that? And when you say I seem angry, you're getting more angry. And there's nothing like a mad woman.
So for the song that I wanted to highlight, it kind of goes back to that idea of effort we both touched on with Taylor Swift, of her always trying so hard. And ironically, I think this new, more relaxed sensibility that I could hear on the album is also heard in the track titled This Is Me Trying. So it's kind of like almost working against its title there. So let's listen to a little bit of This Is Me Trying. So this song makes me wonder, Kathryn, if Taylor Swift maybe found a little bit of grace, a little bit of freedom in her relative isolation, because you have to imagine she's away from fans, she's away from the press, she's away from planning that tour we talked about. All of that stuff sort of fell away. And I do wonder if for some people, the pandemic might have functioned at times like a spiritual retreat of sorts. And I want to be careful here because, you know, for many people, there's been nothing quiet, nothing peaceful about the pandemic at all, especially for those who are in vulnerable situations or those who are essential workers and have not had a break at all. I'm thinking right now of teachers, right? With the back to school season, my wife's got her school library back up and running now. So not everyone has just been chilling during these last couple of months, but I do think that the rat race of modern society was put on hold in a lot of ways. And I can only imagine what the Taylor Swift rat race must feel like. So for her, having that paused was maybe both personally and artistically freeing for her. I don't know. Is there something we can maybe learn from that, Kathryn, about the spiritual value of putting your life on pause, of taking a break from our own trying, whatever that looks like, and maybe leaning a bit more into God's grace?
Yeah. I mean, I guess for Taylor, I think this has been a journey that she has been on. I keep bringing it up, but I think you see more of it in the Netflix documentary, Miss Americana. And I think she has come from a place where she kind of talks about the moment when Kanye West interrupted her and how she has constructed so much of her identity around being a nice girl and well-liked, and how she has now spent years like kind of unraveling that. And I think the grace of the quiet, of not touring, you know, her mom has also been rebattling cancer. Yeah, it's been a grace, I think, in the sense that she's had more space and, you know, was able to create something new when normally she'd be kind of in the hustle bustle of like getting ready to tour. But I also think, you know, effort and trying is just a part of Taylor Swift's personality. And I don't think there's anything wrong with that. To me, I think the thing that she's learned or that we can glean is, what is the point of the effort? Like, are you moving from a place of grace and security, or is it in an effort to like keep up with some rat race or Joneses or maintain some sort of false identity? And I think for a long time for her, it was about this nice girl, like, kind of aw shucks kind of thing, like, you know, the joke about her surprise face. And I just think that what you see more on this album, and that there were glimmers of in other work, I mean, I'm thinking about Clean with Imogene Heap on 1989, is that I think she's just more comfortable and she's more secure in her voice and taking control and working from that place. Like, she's putting an effort from a place of, I know who I am. And I think for Christians, of like, the grace of knowing our identity comes first from God and like working from that place rather than feeling like, okay, I need to keep up with what this person over here is doing with that person over there. And I'm trying to like beat them in some sort of invisible race. And so I do think there's a lesson in like maybe the isolation of it, of just feeling secure in your place and in your gifts and in your sound.
Yeah, we did explore some of those identity questions as they were raised in Miss Americana on a podcast a number of episodes ago about when the documentary came out on Netflix. Michelle Reyes was on that show. And yeah, that was an interesting peek into Taylor Swift's identity, both as the identity we see and the one that she feels like she holds, or at least wants to present as the identity, right? Because there's the public Taylor Swift and then the private Taylor Swift, which that documentary tried to reconcile, I think. But as far as Folklore goes, anything else you wanted to touch on, Kathryn, about the new album?
I love it so much. I think, you know, I always thought like 1989 was her masterpiece. Folklore is, I think, for me, pretty close to 1989. And I think the question, like, people wondered, like, you know, like the joke was like, well, now that she's in a happy relationship, like, what's she going to write about? Uh-huh. And she's shown you like there's still plenty of things and she has lots still to say. And I even love the tie. You know, one of the things I think for me to say, like, why I don't think it's a significant shift is, as much as she worked with Aaron Dressner, she also, Jack Antonoff, who has been a collaborator since 1989, did like 5 or 6 songs on the album as well. So, you know, I do think there is this sort of natural progression and growth. But yeah, I do think, you know, grace, and for those of us that have the privilege, the space that maybe the pandemic has allowed, it can provide a space to explore more things that you maybe didn't have time for before you were stuck at home.
Yeah. For those of us who are able to do some of that, there is maybe a slight advantage there. So that is high praise, Kathryn, for Folklore from you, putting it up there close to 1989. If listeners want more on Folklore, you can head to the TC website. Rachel Sions, who is our social media specialist for Think Christian, she wrote her first TC post about Folklore. So check that out at thinkchristian.net. And as I said, if you want to hear Michelle Reyes and I talk about Miss Americana, the Taylor Swift documentary, that's in a previous episode. Kathryn, thanks for the Swiftie education. Take care of yourself,
thanks,
okay?
Now you know. Bye.
Bye.
Now and then I can lean my back to yours. Traveling like our feet don't touch the floor. Why me? How'd I get this hallelujah?
That's Esta, Danielle, and Alana, known professionally by their surname Haim, bringing that incredible Laurel Canyon, California folk pop style right into today's indie scene. And that song, Hallelujah, listed officially as a bonus track from their new release, Women in Music Part 3, may or may not have been directly influenced by this season of quarantine, considering the group's consistent willingness to contemplate issues related to isolation, depression, fear, and loss. It's hard to tell, but regardless of its origin, Hallelujah could not have come at a better time. Hello, Chaplain John J. Thompson here with another specially curated playlist of songs either directly inspired by and referencing this lingering quarantine season, or at least somehow serving as echoes of the kind of quarantine hymns many of us are likely singing these days. Like it says in Luke 6:45, the mouth speaks, or maybe sings, whatever is built up in the heart. For many of us right now, our hearts are full of questions, concerns, hopes, and yes, prayers that these days will pass. Artists have been dealing with this strange historical, cultural, and even spiritual moment through their music in a wide variety of ways, some with sincerity and transparency, and some with humor. Some express holy discontent, and some have more faith than others that things are going to get better. Some, like Leon Bridges with his song Sweeter, that you will hear a little bit later in the show, sound determined to take advantage of this downtime to do some hard reflecting. And I'll tell you what, this playlist, which is already 40 songs long, is going to keep growing and growing as more sung prayers come to my attention. To listen along, just search for the Think Christian profile on Spotify and hit play. This episode's playlist will be called The Latest Episode for a while and listed as its own mix separately thereafter. And you can hear all of the mixes I've curated for the podcast there, either individually or gathered together in the archive list. And truly, if you come across any other excellent quarantine hymns, tweet at me, at John J. Thompson, and I might add them to this mix. I encourage you to follow this one. I have a feeling it's going to keep growing for quite a while. That's it for now. Until next time, this is John J. Thompson encouraging you to turn it up and sing along.
Abby Olchesi is here to help me consider a surprise quarantine song from Billie Eilish called My Future. Abby, the first lines of the song, here they are. I can't seem to focus. Pretty fitting for life amid the pandemic, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, I'd definitely say so. I've been dealing with focus issues myself.
Yes, just
lately.
Just a little bit, me too. Eilish did write and record My Future with her brother Phineas O'Connell while under quarantine. And if you haven't listened to it yet, I would encourage you to check out the video, the accompanying video for it, because it's this gorgeous Studio Ghibli style animated short from Andrew Onorato. And Abby, that's probably, I imagine, we're going to spend as much time talking about the video as the song. Tell me, you know, just off the top, what you thought of both.
It was a really interesting listening experience and I guess viewing experience for me, because I am not a massive Billie Eilish fan. I wouldn't consider myself super well-versed. I mean, she's also only put out like, what, one studio album. But I think my initial impression of her was that she was kind of, you know, sort of a bratty up-and-comer, which I think is an image that the media kind of embraced early on. But the more I've listened to her, and especially the more I've listened to her after listening to this song, I think there's definitely a very strong songwriting skill and maturity that was just kind of waiting to come to the fore, which I think it finally has in this song. I thought it was really thoughtful and empowering, and the musical element of it was very calming and really lovely in a way that I wasn't expecting.
Yeah, it took me a little bit by surprise too, just having, again, by no means super fan, but having sampled her stuff so far because she's been such a phenomenon. It's definitely a work of introspection. I think that's something that quarantine lends itself to. And at one point in the song, she even sings about just wanting to get to know herself. Maybe that's a good section to take a little sample of here.
Wanna get to know myself.
So there's a taking stock going on there, sort of a reorienting of oneself. Did this strike you as navel-gazing, Abby, or something healthier, something a little deeper?
I think something a little healthier and something a little deeper. And that actually, it spoke very strongly to my own feelings during the whole quarantine experience. So like I live alone. It's just me and my cats hanging out here. And the last several months, I think at the beginning of it, as a pretty social and extroverted person, I felt really a lot of loss of not being able to be around friends and not being able to engage with relationships in the way that I typically would. But something that kind of came in the second round of that was just really, truly getting to know myself more and getting to understand my own like spiritual needs as well, and to understand kind of where certain like deep-seated feelings within myself are coming from. So that was something that really spoke strongly to me. And it also reminded me of Ephesians, of the passage where Paul talks about putting off your old self and putting on your new self, which I felt like the song kind of speaks to a similar process in that you are kind of taking stock of where you are right now and maybe choosing to say goodbye to some older, less healthy parts of yourself and trying to embrace or get to know newer, healthier needs and considering what that might look like for your future in a really hopeful way.
Yeah. And there's a transition like that, that the song really does trace. The music traces and then the video traces it as well, which I don't know if you got this feeling, Abby, but you know, there's, first of all, there's this solitary figure representing Eilish in the video, but the settings are very natural, reminded me a lot of my favorite Hayao Miyazaki film, My Neighbor Totoro. And there's this sense of progression and discovery. There's a distinct shift in the music about 2 minutes in, I think, when Eilish's vocals that have been kind of sleepy up until that point get this kick from a drum track, and then her tempo picks up. And then in the video, there's this transition from sort of a rainy forest scene with the Eilish figure walking through the rain, and then the rain stopping, and then the sun coming out. Maybe that new awareness a little bit that you're thinking of.
I know supposedly I'm lonely now. No, I'm supposed to be unhappy without someone. But aren't I someone?
Definitely. And yeah, it becomes just sort of, as the music becomes brighter, the visuals become brighter as well. And there's like all of this like literal growth and joyfulness and a real change coming over it.
The other film that the video reminded me of was not just Totoro, but actually going all the way back to Bambi, also an animated film. And that beautiful sequence in Bambi of the storm where the thunder is raging and the rain is pelting down, the animals are all hiding. And then you get a similar transition, right? The clouds roll away, the sun comes back. There is a real spiritual solace to that Bambi sequence for me that I think the My Future video captures. It makes me think of the consoling prayer offered by Christian mystic Julian of Norwich, the one that goes, all will be well, and all will be well, and every manner of thing will be well. I can't say I expected that sort of Christian hope to be echoed by Billie Eilish and bring sort of some sunlight into the pandemic, Abby. But, you know, these are strange times. And so who knows what to expect from something like this?
Yeah, absolutely. This was, I think, not the kind of thing that I would have expected from her either. And I think when you had originally talked to me about coming on and talking about this, I was kind of preparing myself for something a little grim and something a little bit of a bummer. And then I watched it and it was really joyful and sweet. And I think it's a song that I'm probably going to be coming back to a lot and just kind of enjoying for the sort of simple and renewing power that it has.
Yeah, I'd agree. We did talk a little bit on the TC website a while back, 2019 actually, about some of those other elements of Eilish's music or persona when Chris Wheeler wrote a post that's called Who's Afraid of Billie Eilish? So check that out if maybe you're new to Billie Eilish and want to find out a little bit about her earlier music too. But thank you, Abby, for coming on to talk about My Future. We'll talk again soon, okay?
All right, thanks.
I thought we moved on from the darker days. The words of the king disappear in the air like a butterfly. Somebody should hand you a felony.
Cause you stole from me my chance to be hoping for a life more sweeter. Instead, I'm just a story repeat.
That's Leon Bridges alongside Terrace Martin on Sweeter, another quarantine release that isn't a hymn as much as a lament. This time of pandemic has also seen increased outrage over police brutality against Black people. There was another shooting of an unarmed Black man, Jacob Blake, in Kenosha, Wisconsin, the weekend before we recorded this. Bridges, he put out Sweeter in the wake of George Floyd's killing at the hands of police back in May in Minneapolis. We spend a lot more time on that subject on our previous Black Lives Matter episode, so check that out if you missed it. You can hear Bridges' Sweeter and Haim's Hallelujah on the Spotify playlist to accompany this episode. John J. Thompson put together another diverse collection of tracks. You can find it by searching for the Think Christian playlist on Spotify. And if you want to diversify it some more, well, send some quarantine hymn suggestions John's way on Twitter. He's at John J. Thompson. You can also follow today's guests on Twitter. Kathryn Freeman is at Kathryn Annette, and Abby Olchesi is at Abby Olchesi. Thanks to both of them for joining me. I'm Larson on Film on Twitter, and you can follow TC at Think Christian. Now, I've mentioned a few TC articles on this episode. I should probably add that Joel Mayward has also written about the new Haim album for us. If you want to make sure you don't miss any of our posts, subscribe to receive our emails at thinkchristian.net/subscribe. And don't forget, we're always open for your comments, questions, and suggestions about the show. You can email us at tcpodcast@thinkchristian.net. The Think Christian Podcast is a production of Reframe Media, a family of programs designed to help you see your whole life reframed by God's gospel story. Visit reframemedia.com for more info. Our audio engineer and post-production supervisor is John Reeder, and Reframe's co-director overseeing content strategy is Robin Basselin. Thanks a lot for listening. I'll be back in a couple of weeks to consider how another aspect of our pop culture fandom connects with our faith.